Hello, I'm Ben Godwin. Welcome to the Word Workshop, recorded at the Good Springs Full Gospel Church.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
My wife Michelle and I have pastored the Good Springs Full Gospel Church since 1999. A spirit-filled church with a hunger for God and a heart for people. Good Springs Full Gospel Church is located in Walker County on Highway 269, 10 miles south of Jasper.
The prophet said that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
So prepare your hearts to receive from the Word, because when all else fails, God's Word works.
Hallelujah. Well, I didn't get to preach last week, so I'm ready. Both barrels. Hallelujah. Amen. Got some good things to share with you. I want to share this from Tony Evans. I like this graphic that I found. It says, the closer you live to God, the smaller everything else appears. Amen. He can handle it all. Good news. How about this from C.S. Lewis, the great author? He said, obedience isn't legalism, it's a symptom of salvation. Jesus said, if you love me, what are you going to do? Keep my commandments. Amen. This blessed me. It says, don't let your bad days trick you into believing you're having a bad life. We all have bad days, don't we? But how many know you have a good life in Jesus? You're blessed. Amen. How about this? This is sobering. There is a 0.0296% chance, that's less than 1%, that your child will become a professional athlete. There is a 100% chance that your child will stand before Jesus. So get them in church. Amen. Praise God. It's wonderful to make touchdowns and hit home runs and all that stuff, but how many know the spiritual is most important? Amen. Don't neglect the spiritual. This cracked me up for musicians. You know what this is. It says, I don't know what song this is, but surely it's Pentecostal. And at the end of the song, it says, repeat forever. When all else fails, sing it again. Hallelujah. That's what we do. Got to laugh at ourselves, right? Praise the Lord. How about this? You can relate to this. This car fainted after it saw the price of gas. We're going to have to pray about these. Did you know a year ago, oil sold for $60 a barrel? It's now at $98 a barrel and climbing. So we need to pray about that, don't we? One more, old Forrest Gump, he's everywhere. Do you know what it means when the preacher is getting long-winded and he looks at his watch? Nothing. It means absolutely nothing. Smile, it won't hurt you. Praise the Lord. Well, I've been doing a little series on Wednesday nights, and I want to try to finish this up. Parallels between Noah's day and the last days. Parallels between Noah's day and the last days. Go with me to Matthew 24, if you will, please. Matthew 24. I'm going to read three verses. Verses 37 through 39. Jesus prophesied that in the last days preceding his second coming, that they would be similar and comparable to the times of Noah. And we're going to do a little study on that. For you that are my Wednesday night crew, be a little patient. I'm going to do some review for our TV audience. So you just shout amen like you never heard some of it, all right? Amen. Appreciate that. Let's go to the scripture. Matthew 24, 37. Here's what it says. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Next verse. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. Verse 39, and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. History seems to be cyclical. It seems to repeat itself. Someone said this, and it made me laugh. What we learn from history is that we don't learn anything from history, because it seems like we keep going through the same cycle. And Jesus said, as it was in Noah's time, it's going to be similar as we approach the second coming. How many can look in the world and see signs of the times that we are getting closer? I had a conversation this week with a business owner. He looked at me and he said, Brother Ben, he said, how close do you think we are to going home? How close do you think we are to the coming of Jesus? And here's what I told him, and I don't have time to elaborate on this. I just want to put them up there for your reference. I told him in Matthew 24, this chapter, there are 12 specific signs Jesus gave leading up to his second coming and the end of the world. 10 of these are happening in the world right now. So let me ask you, how close do you think we are? I joke about it, but it's really not a joke. After 40 years of Bible study, I finally figured out when Jesus is coming. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Amen? Look at somebody say, it may be sooner than you think. No man knows the hour or the day, not even the Son or the angels. But I know it's getting close. I said, I know it's getting close. The evidence is in the world around us. Now, here's a little reminder. In the Netherlands, this opened up. A replica of Noah's Ark was built by Johan Hubers. It opened up December 10th, 2012. And then you've heard about the Ark Encounter up in Williamstown, Kentucky. We had the privilege of going up there. Since we have a son named Noah, I thought it was important that we go see the Ark, right? Somebody said, if you need a boat, I know a guy. No, just a pun there. All right. But look at this. This was June 15th, 2017. Our family went up and saw the Ark Encounter, and it was impressive. And we may get a trip up maybe later this year if anyone is interested in going to see it. It is spectacular, and they've added more stuff to it since we went. But look how massive that door is. It's just incredible. But here's the number one takeaway. When you study the story of Noah's Ark, when you study Genesis chapter 6, and I want you to turn there in your Bibles because we're going to look at a few things. The number one takeaway, the number one biggest point is real simple. Don't miss the boat. Say it with me. Don't miss the boat. All right, the ark is a symbol of salvation. If you're not safely in the ark of salvation, you will drown in sin. Jesus said, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? We get so distracted and so fixated on things that are carnal and temporary and earthly that are all going to vanish one day and don't mean a hill of beans in the light of eternity. We've got to keep our number one focus on spiritual things. Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And what? All these other things will take care of themselves. But let him be first in your life. You say, well, that's just an Old Testament fairy tale, a kid's story I learned in Sunday school. Well, think about this. Did you know Noah is mentioned 8 times by name in the New Testament? Not just an Old Testament story. It's mentioned 8 times Noah is in the New Testament. Jesus referred to this as a literal historical happening, not just a myth or a legend. And notice how, as we just read in Matthew 24, what were people consumed with? Eating, drinking, marrying, business as usual, parties, weddings. They were oblivious to the danger and they ignored God's warnings. Then suddenly they were swept away. Jesus compared his coming to a thief in the night. How does a thief in the night come? Does he call you up in advance and say, better get your gun, I'm coming to steal your jewelry? He comes unannounced, unexpectedly, without warning. And that's how the coming of Jesus will happen. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and say, we better be ready. Hallelujah. Ready or not, Jesus is coming. The people of Noah's time were indifferent, they were indulgent, and they were ignorant. Two guys were having a conversation, and one said, what do you think's worse in America, ignorance or apathy? He said, I don't know and I don't care. Unfortunately, that's how a lot of people are. They don't know and they don't care. Ignorance is bliss. Well, how many believe we ought to care? We need to care about the condition of our country. We need to care about the condition of our world. And we ought to be interceding, hallelujah, that God will pour out his spirit once again in a fresh and new way in these last days. Hallelujah. Unrepentant sinners are like a man who jumps out of a 50th floor window. Halfway down, someone asked him, how you doing? He said, I'm doing fine so far. You may be doing fine on your own right now, but it's not going to end well if you're not saved. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. How many believe it pays to serve God? It pays to serve the devil too. You just won't like the paycheck. The wages of sin is death, but how many are glad the gift of God is eternal life? Elbow somebody, say, I'm going to live forever. Hallelujah. I'm going to live forever. Praise the Lord. Noah was 500 years old when God told him to build the ark. He was 600 years old when the flood came. Think of that. So he spent, different people estimate, 80 to 100 years building the ark, preaching and warning the wicked to flee the wrath of God. Look at this scripture with me from 2 Peter 2:5. It says that God did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood of the world of the ungodly. Think about that. Preach for 80 to 100 years. And how many people got saved? Seven people got on the ark with him, and they were his own family. But how many know, praise God, in these last days, there's only one family going to be spared. That's the family of God. How many are glad you're in that family? The blood washed, born again, family of God. Hallelujah. Look at somebody say, you're in the right family. Hallelujah. You're in the right family. Praise God. Let me show you a quick lesson in mercy, about the mercy of God. I'll tell you why Anthony Hopkins is on there in just a minute. All right, how could a God of love drown all those innocent people in a watery grave, some people would ask. Well, let me say, first of all, they weren't so innocent, as you will see. How many know the Bible says there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that doeth good. There is none good but God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Listen, none of us deserve salvation. But how many thank God by grace we've been saved through faith? That not of ourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Thank God for grace. Amen. All right. But think about this. God warned them through Noah for over 100 years and gave them numerous opportunities to repent and be saved. People rejected God's offer of salvation back then, and how many know people are rejecting God's offer of salvation now? As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also. Listen, hell is not full of people who God rejected. Hell is full of people who rejected God. John 6:37, Jesus said, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and those who come to me, I will in no wise cast them out. He will accept you if you repent. He will accept you if you believe. He will accept you if you accept his terms. Problem is, people want to come to God on their terms. Anthony Hopkins played Methuselah in the horrible movie back in 2014 called Noah. It was a terrible rendition of the story. But here's what I want you to see. Methuselah means flood at my death. Or it shall be sent, implying a deluge, a flood was coming. He was named by his father Enoch. Remember Enoch, the one who was not, the one that God raptured out of this world? Praise God. A preacher friend of mine said, Americans have astronauts, Russians have cosmonauts. Enoch was a was not. I mean, one day we're going to be was nots too. Hallelujah. Praise God. But think about this. Enoch had a revelation from God that something was coming. So when he had a son, he named his son Methuselah, which means flood at my death, or it shall be sent. And so what did God do with Methuselah? He made his the longest lifespan of any human in recorded history, 969 years. So the prophecy was judgment is coming, but God didn't make his life the shortest lifespan. He made it the longest to give man more time to repent. God was showing his mercy even before the judgment came. Hallelujah. Notice this about Methuselah. His birth was a prophecy, basically, that God's judgment was coming, and God made his lifespan the longest. So even in judgment, God was extending mercy and giving man the maximum amount of time to repent and be saved. How many know it's not God's will that any should perish? I said it's not God's will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance and to life. Amen. Now, real quick, I don't have time to park on these. We've already covered these on Wednesday night, but for you Sunday folks and you folks by television, I just want you to be aware of them. Parallels between Noah's time and our time. The Bible says in Genesis 6:1, when it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, there was a population explosion. Does anybody know how many children are born every day in the world? You have a wild guess. This blew my mind. I Googled this. 385,000 children born every day in this world. That equates to 140 million per year. Some 55.3 die annually. So there's a 2.5 ratio of births to deaths. And there's a population explosion. There are 7.5 billion people alive on this planet right now. Many of them don't know God. Many of them are totally blind and ignorant of spiritual things. How many are glad God has revealed himself to you? Amen? You're among the blessed, all right? So there's a population explosion. Number two, there were ungodly marriages. Verse 6, it says, sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful. They took wives of themselves of all they chose. Now, there's nothing wrong with getting married, except these, it's implied in the text, these were ungodly marriages. It was either polygamy or it was godly people marrying ungodly people, and it resulted in them being unequally yoked. And God was upset with this that was going on. Well, if that angered God, what about the same-sex civil unions that are happening in the world today? Let me tell you, historically, traditionally, and biblically, marriage has always been one man and one woman. Not two men, not two women, or any other combination. Yeah. And what upsets me is the fact that I believe it was 27 states in America voted down on their amendments, same-sex marriage, and then the Supreme Court overruled the majority just a few years ago. My friend, we're living in the last days. If it's not obvious, just look at the perversion that's in the world today. You know I'm telling you the truth. All right, look at this third part. Reduce lifespans. Look at verse 3. And God says, my spirit's not going to strive with man forever. He is indeed flesh. His days shall be 120 years. In other words, God drastically reduced the lifespan. If you read the previous chapter, Genesis 5, Genesis 4, people lived 900 plus years. Can you imagine living that long? Of course, they didn't age as fast either. But God said, you know what? If man's going to live 900 years and use his days to sin, then I'm going to reduce his lifespan. Chopped it down to 120 as an average. But now the average lifespan in America is 79 years. 79 years. That seems like a long time, but how many know in the light of eternity, it's just a drop in the bucket. Gone before you know it. The blink of an eye. Life is a vapor. It appears for a short time and it vanishes away, the Bible says. So God reduced the lifespan. Many people's lives are cut short due to sin or the evil that's in the world. Widespread wickedness. Look at verse 5. It says, the Lord saw that wickedness of man was great in the earth, that every intent of the thoughts of his heart were only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. Widespread wickedness. Jesus said this. He said in Matthew 24, because iniquity will abound, the love of many will wax cold. In other words, people are carried away with evil. Think about it. There are no new sins being committed in the world today. There are just more sinners alive on the earth to sin at one time. And technology has made sin easily accessed and convenient. But God still hates sin. But aren't you glad he loves the sinner? Whew, hallelujah. Thank God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Here's another thing. Rampant violence. Genesis 6, look at verse 11 with me. The earth was corrupt before God. And the earth was what? Filled with violence. Verse 13, God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me. The earth is filled with violence. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Violence. There's a saying in the news industry among journalists. If it bleeds, it leads. In other words, if there's death, injury, or tragedy, that's going to be the top story on the news. You know, every night you watch the news. Do you see much good news? What do you see? Murders and crime and violence and tragedy. And the earth is filled with that stuff. How many know it's time to keep our eyes on Jesus? If you keep your eyes on what's going on in the world, you'll be discouraged. You might even be end up in despair. But if you keep your eyes on Jesus, hallelujah, you know there's hope and there's help in God. Amen? Hallelujah. How about this? Mass deception. Jesus said it. He said, and they knew not. They did not know until the flood came and took them all away. We're in the same condition now. Mass deception. People are blind spiritually. They're oblivious to how serious a time that we live in right now. But here's the good news, and here's what I want to emphasize. Number 7 is this. God had a righteous remnant. Look at verse 8. But Noah found grace or favor in the eyes of the Lord. Where sin abounds, say it with me, grace does much more abound. Come on, say it again. Where sin abounds, grace does much more. Yes, there's plenty of sin in this world, but how many glad we still can find grace and favor in the eyes of the Lord? Hallelujah! God still has a remnant, a righteous remnant. No, we're not perfect. No, we're far from it. But how many are striving to please God and striving to do what you know is right in your heart? Well, then you're part of that righteous remnant. I love the story when Elijah was in the cave and he was complaining to God. He said, I'm the only one left. They've killed all your prophets. They've thrown down the altars. They're all worshiping Baal. I'm the only one left. And God said, wait a minute, buddy. No, you're not. He said, I've got 7,000 men that are hidden away who will not bow their knee to Baal or kiss his image. And Paul wrote in the book of Romans, said, even now there is a remnant according to the election of grace. How many are glad you're part of that remnant? You may not realize it, but you being in that righteous remnant is what is keeping darkness from totally overrunning this world. It's keeping judgment at bay. Hallelujah. Judgment will come one day, but how many agree it doesn't have to happen on our watch? We can pray and intercede, and it can change the whole atmosphere in our country. If my people, say it, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, God said, then I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Somebody wave your hand and say, do it, Lord. Heal our land, oh God. Heal our land, oh God. 8 people. God started over with 8 people. By the way, 8 in the Bible is significant. It means new beginnings because God started all over with 8 people with Noah. But even in the week, you have 7 days in a week, and the 8th day is a new week, a new beginning. all Jewish males were circumcised on the eighth day. It's a significant number in the Bible, a number of new beginnings, and I'm believing for a new beginning. A new beginning. Hallelujah. Now, let me show you a couple more things here that I find interesting about this story. This is Hebrews 11:7. It says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, notice that phrase, moved with fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. One of those things he had never seen before was rain. It had never rained. God caused a mist to come up out of the ground to water all of the vegetation. It had never rained. And yet Noah, even though he'd never seen rain, he acted in faith. I mean, there's some things we've never seen, but we know it's true because of the word of God. We need to act on it anyway. Faith without works is? So put some action to our faith. Amen? Now, let's go through some of the details of the ark. I love this. I don't know if you're interested in it, but I love this. God gave Noah the blueprint for the ark. Every detail is significant. We kind of skim through our Bible. We kind of gloss over the details and you know, look for the big picture. But God put these details there to speak things spiritually that are significant to us. So let's go through some of these details real rapid fire here if we can. Number one, the ark is a symbol of salvation. Only one family was spared and saved from judgment. The same is going to be true in the last days. The family of God. There are three arks in the Bible. Brother Ray and I were talking about this before Sunday school. There are three arks mentioned in the Bible. You have Noah's ark, of course. You have Moses' ark. Remember the basket his mother put him in? And then you have the Ark of the Covenant. All three of these arks have to do with preservation. Hallelujah. How many know God is going to preserve his people? God has a good track record of taking care of his people. Amen? All right, so that has to do with preservation. One family was saved, as we mentioned. How about this? There was one ark, but there were three floors or three levels. That's a God showing Noah something about himself. There is one God who is manifest in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit. Couple of more details here. Notice this. I like this. Did you know the ark was pitched inside and outside? So it had a double seal. Everybody say a double seal. It had to be waterproof, right? You don't float on a flood for 40 days and 40 nights and then months beyond that without having waterproof. Waterproofing. It was sealed inside and outside. Had a double seal. Well, let me share some good news with you. You have a double seal. You've been sealed by the blood of Jesus Christ, and you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. Isn't that what Paul said? Grieve not the Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Why don't you lift your hand and say, thank God I've been sealed. Hallelujah. What does a seal do? Real simply, a seal keeps the good stuff in and keeps the bad stuff out. You can't get any simpler than that. How many ladies ever done any canning before? Mason jars, you know what I'm talking about? You get that corn, those green beans, those tomatoes, whatever. And what do? You put them in there. You fasten that seal, and what happens? It keeps the freshness in. It keeps contamination out. Well, if you've been sealed by the blood of Jesus and sealed by the Holy Spirit, hallelujah, he's keeping the freshness of your walk with God in, and he's keeping the contamination of the world out. How many thank God you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit? Amen. Praise the Lord. Look at a couple other little details here that I think are interesting. One window, and notice where it was put. It's a little small window, cubit and a half. That's not a big window for a huge ark. Notice where God told him to put it, in the top. He didn't put it in the side because he didn't want Noah looking out and seeing all the suffering and the drowning masses. He had one window and he said, you put it in the top. Where did God want him to look? Didn't Jesus say, when you see all these things coming to pass, not look down, not look around, look up. Say it with me, look up. Your redemption draweth nigh. One of your favorite Psalms, Brother Jerry, is at 121, I will look to the hills from whence cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord. I'm not looking down. I'm not looking around. I'm looking up in Jesus' name. He's my source. He's my helper. Hallelujah. A couple other little details I want you to see about the ark here. Notice this. There was one door and it had no dimensions. God gave them the measurements for how long it was, the ark, how wide the ark was, how tall the ark was, how big the window was. But when it came to the door, he didn't give him any measurements. No dimensions. When I think about what that door represents, it speaks to me of the fact that Jesus, the door, isn't that what he said in John 10? I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. There's no limit to how much he can save. Hallelujah. He can save to the what? Or the guttermost. Hallelujah. He can save. Isaiah 59, the arm of the Lord is not short that he cannot save. His ear is not heavy that he cannot hear. Hallelujah. Unlimited power for Jesus to save. Glory to his name. Now think about this. There were no measurements on that door, and there was only one door. Somebody say there's only one door. Hallelujah. Jesus is not a door. He's not a way. He is the way. He is the door. Amen. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 2:5, there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Acts 4 says, there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Jesus is the one and only door of salvation. And then notice in Genesis 7:6, here's what the Bible says. It says, God shut the door. That door was open for weeks, maybe months. We don't know. We're not told. But there came a time when God shut the door. The same is true with salvation. Salvation is readily available. Whosoever will, let him come and drink of the water of life freely. But that door of grace will not be open forever, my friend. There's going to come a time when that door is going to shut. And you want to be on the inside looking out, not on the outside looking in. Amen? Hallelujah. God shut the door. And then think about this. I love this fact. There's no record in here that Noah and his sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, no record that they went out and caught animals. There's no record that they laid any traps, had any snares. I don't see Noah out there with a butterfly net trying to catch a moth or a butterfly or some bird. What happened? When it was God's time, are you hearing me? When it was God's time, a magnetic pull from their creator drew every one of those creatures toward that ark. I just don't see Noah out there with a bird call. I don't see him out there, you know, howling like a coon dog trying to get here, kitty, kitty. There was a supernatural draw that brought those animals to the ark. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. Are you hearing me? There's going to be a supernatural drawing of the Holy Ghost that's going to bring people to salvation. Yeah, you can witness to them. You can show them the love of God. We have church programs to reach out to the lost. But let me tell you something. When it's God's time, hallelujah, people are going to respond like never before, and they're going to come into the ark of safety. Do you believe that? That's what I'm praying for. That's what I believe. Hallelujah. Are you getting anything out of this? Look at this. I love this. This will make me shout. The ark started on the plain, the low place. But where did it end up? You read the text. It said the ark landed in the mountains of Ararat. That's somewhere in modern day Turkey. There are people that claim they found the ark and done excavations up on that mountain. I don't know if they did or not. But I know one thing. It started in a low place. It ended in a high place. What's true of that is true of the church, and it's true of you. Every storm the enemy brings into your life to destroy you, God only uses it to take you higher in him. The enemy wants to take you under. The enemy wants to drown you. Hallelujah. But God is using it to take you higher. How many are glad you're going higher in God? Hallelujah. Glory to his name. all the storms in your life, God is using to take them higher. Now, real quick, I got to do some rapid fire and wrap this up. Number one, there had to be some supernatural light. One window, and it's not glass. So probably a wooden window. No electricity. You burn candles, it burns up your oxygen. There had to be some supernatural light on that ark. So had to be, all right? Number two, there had to be some supernatural air. No air conditioning. Can you imagine? On a floating zoo with a bunch of stinking pets. Can you imagine the smell? I think God just allowed his breath to permeate that ark. There had to be some supernatural air in there. Hallelujah. Just like God breathed on Adam in the Garden of Eden. God, like Jesus breathed on his disciples in the upper room, said, "Receive ye the Holy Spirit." I believe the breath of God filled that ark. Praise God. There had to be some supernatural food. Food spoils. Food rots. No refrigeration. Think about that. They were in the ark for a year and approximately 27 days, if my math is correct. So God either suppressed their appetite or he stretched what they had. Somehow, some way, God supernaturally intervened with that ark. How about this? I pointed this out Wednesday night. It didn't have a steering wheel. It didn't have a rudder. It had no means for man to control where it was going. Why? Because God was in control. Woo, hallelujah. Noah wasn't sitting there driving down the flood, the river. Come on. Hallelujah. God navigated that ark exactly where he wanted. How many know the steps of a good man or woman are ordered of God? Rip that sticker off of your car if it's on there. God is my co-pilot. Baloney, he better not be your co-pilot. He better be your pilot. Hallelujah. He better be your pilot and you his co-pilot. He's our navigator. He is the captain of our ship. Hallelujah. And then notice this. I believe there was supernatural peace on that ark. There was no fighting. I don't see animals getting into a big fight. Predators and prey, I don't see that. I believe there was peace and there was harmony and unity, kind of like there was in the Garden of Eden before the fall. Supernatural. Somebody say supernatural. And Noah built this thing with no Home Depot. No power saws, no nail guns, none of the modern things. Listen, God had to be in this. And it brings me to what the psalm says, unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain that build it. We can do all of our own works and it not amount to anything, but if God gets in it, somebody say, if God gets in it, woo, it will prosper, amen? Hallelujah. All right, I got to wrap this up. I got to land this boat. I usually say plane, but I got to land this boat. Notice this, God baptized the whole earth in water. But it didn't cure the sin problem. John the Baptist said in Matthew 3:11, I indeed baptize you with water under repentance, but he that comes after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. Finish it with me. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Water baptism was not enough. And the next time God destroys the earth, you can read about it in 2 Peter 3:10 through 13, he's going to destroy it with fire. Why? Water cleanses, but fire purifies. John had the waterworks. Jesus brought the fireworks. You need to be baptized in water. It's important. It's necessary. It's part of the salvation experience. But let me tell you, you need more than water baptism. You need the fire baptism that only the Holy Spirit can give. Hallelujah. Think about this. So somebody said, well, let's just get rid of all the sinners and then we'll get rid of the sin problem. And God drowned all of the evil people in Noah's day. But guess what? A few generations later, Noah's descendants were committing the same things, same sins as the people before. That just shows you how man's heart is bent toward evil. Like a bug to a light, we gravitate toward evil. That's why we need the regenerating power of the blood of Jesus. That's why we need the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit, because we can't do it alone. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Let me reiterate real strong. Don't miss the boat. Say it with me. Don't miss the boat. If you miss God's provision of salvation, you've missed everything. So let me ask you, are you saved? Are you right with God? Are you ready to meet God right now? Russia invaded Ukraine this week. This world is in chaos. This world is in turmoil and upheaval. We're not guaranteed tomorrow. We need to be ready to meet God at any time. Be prepared in your heart and in your spirit. And let me say this with confidence, the door is still open. I said the door is still open. We don't know how long it'll be open, but the door of grace and salvation is still open. And Jesus says, whosoever will, let him come and drink of the water of life freely. Amen. Will you stand with me, please? Hallelujah. Lord, I've done my best to share what you gave me to these people today. Hello everyone, this is Pastor Ben Godwin, thanking you for watching our broadcast today. I pray it has been a blessing and a source of spiritual enrichment for you and your family. I'd like to invite you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where you can view many more singing and preaching videos. Search for Good Springs Full Gospel Church at youtube.com. Also, please visit our website at goodspringsfgc.org. where you can learn more about our church and ministry, read many of my articles on a variety of subjects, find a direct link to our YouTube channel, shop our online store, and donate to our church and help support our TV ministry with debit, credit card, or PayPal. Also, you can mail in an offering the old-fashioned way to Good Springs Full Gospel Church, P.O. Box 3161, Jasper, Alabama, 35502. If we can assist you in any way in your spiritual journey, please contact us. And remember, when all else fails, God's word works.